why not all Lucio?
Oh, hello there, my wunderbar patients. This is the Dr. DrJoeystein, a little bit of Overwatch. And before I start, you know, I have a great play of the game I got recently. I want to show it to you, so here you go. Anyway, I gotta get that.
Play of the game.
I'm not prone to get engrossed in video games these days. Sure, I'll actively praise one and proclaim its greatness to others while it's got my attention for a time, but usually it needs to be brought up in conversation several months after I've played it for me to say something about it. I usually stop playing most games as soon as I finish their campaigns or have had my fill of their other modes, but there are the rare exceptions where I just can't get enough of a certain game beyond its core experience. These may all be good games in theory, but how long one is important to me and preoccupies my mind determines how much I play and talk about it. For example, I would enthusiastically tell you that Assassin's Creed 4 Black Flag is still one of the best titles in the series since Brotherhood. It's fun to navigate the Caribbean islands by land or sea, and cool how the narrative takes intriguing twists with how it handles the future and historical storylines. It's a great game, by all means, but once I had gone through the campaign, I felt no desire to linger in it. I moved on to other titles and filed this one away because I wasn't interested in the multiplayer or acquiring every collectible. Now, if we're talking about Call of Duty Black Ops or Transformers War for Cybertron, those were games that consumed my attention for months. I went through the main experiences they offered, but went on to play their campaigns twice on harder difficulties, spend inordinate amounts of time in their multiplayer modes, and earn their platinum trophies. My point in saying those things? There's a special difference between games that grab your attention for a short time versus a prolonged time. And I'm not talking about games designed to be short. I'm referring to games that can be hypothetically enjoyed for hours beyond the main show, with extra content and multiplayer-centered modes. They try to entice you with more if you dabble in the additional stuff, but many of these games just don't motivate you enough to put in the extra effort. It's not that they're bad, it's just that they've outstayed their welcome, I guess. I just move on to the next game because I'd much rather experience more games at a decent pace than spend all of my time in one, but it's happened in the past. I may not play those games anymore that I mentioned, but they had me hooked for much longer than usual. And you know, I sort of miss that kind of burning, lasting passion for one game that just clicks with me. And I tell you, if a game did manage to do that to me today, it would have to be exceptionally good. If I devote myself to one game not for review purposes or simply because it's long, but because I simply can't get enough of it beyond average playtimes, I know it must speak to me on an intimate level. Overwatch is that kind of game. And the reason why is because it reignited that old flame of burning, lasting passion that I used to have, or rarely have today, for a single game. It's something that I can't stop gushing about. It's something that I can't stop thinking about either. And it's also something, well, that I can't stop playing. Overwatch reminds me of the days of my teenage youth, spent year-round playing at least 1 to 2 hours of Call of Duty a day until the next one came out. I haven't had habitual cycles like that with a game in forever, because I actually try to manage my time playing games. Well, Overwatch won't have any of that with me. It's a multiplayer first-person shooter that I'm compelled to delve into every day. But what could make it so good that my interest in it has yet to wane in the slightest? Let me tell you how that's possible, with a game that never fails to suck you back in with its infectious charm and glorious gameplay. Story. Overwatch doesn't have a campaign. Any kind of plot or character details that form a tapestry of its lore can be ignored without compromising the primary enjoyment the game brings, much like with the Soul series, Tom Clancy's The Division, or, arguably, I might add, Destiny. However, while you're slowly familiarizing yourself with all the characters and world they inhabit while playing, willingly not paying attention to the backstories would prove to be an immense challenge since they're so interesting. Characters will briefly banter with cryptic lines and telling words that reveal their relationships with one another, the history behind maps, their individual motivations and quirks, and more. So when it comes to these characters, where do they come from? How do they know each other? What's the state of the world? It all stems from a group of heroes under the titular title of Overwatch.
Aren't you supposed to be dead?
Didn't take.
Is this on? Yeah, it's on. In the not-so-distant future, humanity is having a golden age of prosperity and innovation, particularly in the field of robotics with Omnix. These robots with advanced AI capabilities stun the world with what they could do, prompting the construction of Omnium factories in key locations around the globe. As we all know, though, AI always goes wrong at some point. The Omniums began producing murderous Omnix en masse, quickly forming armies that posed a serious threat. While no one knows why this occurred and how, the United Nations created a small task force of heroes called Overwatch, which was created to rescue humanity from this Omnic crisis. Heroes such as Jack Morrison, Gabriel Reyes, Reinhardt Wilhelm, and Angela Ziegler are a few of the original leading members who fought back the Omnics and saved the world, inspiring old and new generations with its deeds and continued existence to preserve order and safety long after the Omnic crisis. Overwatch was unfortunately accused of misconduct, corruption, and other unethical practices as time marched on. Turmoil brewing in its ranks didn't help the situation either, which resulted in a devastating attack on Overwatch's headquarters and its forced disbandment with the United Nations Petrus Act. Veterans of the glory days and new promising rookies could no longer work together, opting to go their own ways. However, with a second Omnic crisis on the rise, a shocking campaign of civil rights for neutral sentient Omnics, and criminal activity increasing day after day, Overwatch is recalled. The world needs its heroes more than ever.
You wouldn't think all of this would be in the game, and, well, you'd be right. A lot of this stuff is regulated to short animations, comic books, and website biographies. However, the tantalizing quotes characters utter and subtle visual storytelling around maps provide great incentive to go out and study this zany universe. Much of this has to do with the perfectly crafted characters. And boy, never have I seen a more ethnically and culturally diverse group of wildly disparate personalities in any game. People from all over the world are represented here, from a Brazilian DJ, to a Chinese female scientist, to a Japanese cyborg, to a pink-haired female Russian athlete turned soldier. And yes, those are all accurate descriptions. Many have rightly pointed out that they're so unique that Soldier 76, a seemingly generic Call of Duty guy, ironically feels like the odd one out here. But even he has a more interesting backstory and character design than most multiplayer characters. They're all truly likable in their own ways, and you're sure to not only connect with some of them, but also others that you'll come to love if they happen to match your playstyle. That pink-haired female Russian I mentioned, I never thought I would like her because she never appealed to me, but because I play as her half the time due to her awesome abilities, she's one of my favorite characters now. In other words, you'll either come to adore new playstyles by using characters you love from the get-go, or attach to characters you never thought you'd like because they feel great to master. It's a clever, ingenious way to have players experiment and relate to all 21 individuals. But how do they play and complement each other? What's the gameplay like?
Oh, gameplay? Woo! Strap in, you're in for the long haul.
Gameplay. Overwatch is a team-oriented game, and I sincerely stress that. Strategic coordination, balanced team composition, and minds focused on the objective rather than solo kills are essential components to victory. This isn't your average multiplayer shooter where you can run around on your own and play however you please. You'll be wiped out in a moment's notice if you go on thinking like that. With two teams of six players each, you'll either be escorting a slow-moving vehicle to its destination in escort, attacking two major points that the other team must defend in assault, or battling for control of a single point in, well, control. Respectively, they're similar modes to Team Fortress 2's Payload, Attack/Defend, and King of the Hill. And while people have compared Overwatch to MOBAs like League of Legends, it's only similar on the basis of having several classes of characters focused on particular roles. However, while it mainly pulls this one inspiration from the MOBA genre, it does so to the extreme. The game goes overboard with a boatload of characters, and that's one of the key things that makes it so successful. Unlike characters in loosely defined classes with Team Fortress 2, even more characters occupy specific roles with varying specialties in Overwatch. The Assault class, for example, has Soldier 76, your typical mid-range gunner with a sprinting ability, grenade launcher, and healing apparatus.
Come here, get some nutrition! Don't worry, kids. I've got peanut butter sandwiches ready to go. I've got applesauce, string cheese, goldfish. I got crackers. We obviously can't forget the juice boxes. Come on. I've even got dessert for you, kids. I got Skittles. And, I got your favorite. Come on, get over here.
Oh, 76. Ever the protective, edgy father. Oh, anyway. Others like Genji are nothing like this. He can throw shurikens in two different ways, climb walls and double jump, deflect bullets for a limited time, and slice forward quickly with his sword. Both of these characters may be focused on damage, but the ways in which they deliver it are as dissimilar as how the other four characters in this class do so too. This means that each character has nuanced purposes for any given situation. Is the enemy closely crowding a point you want to capture? Pharah is a phenomenal choice to deal with this, who can fly around and launch rocket barrages from above. And this isn't including her special ability that sends out a rocket which blows enemies back. She's still an assault character, but can accomplish what Soldier 76 and Genji couldn't do as effectively. The same point extends to the support class, which is an even more diverse group consisting of long-range eliminators like the bow-wielding Hanzo or sniper Widowmaker and the turret-placing Torbjorn or Bastion, who's a robotic turret himself. And just as varying types of defense are needed to stay behind lines, the front lines need their tanks as well. Reinhardt is the quintessential one with massive health, a shield that blocks up to 2,000 damage points, a blunt hammer, and a horrifying charge that will pin anyone to a wall. Some tanks are focused on more damage and individual defense like Zarya, while another named Winston is an expert in distracting the enemy since he can leap large distances and send out waves of electricity. Lastly, the support class is an underplayed yet key one that heals their teams. Someone like Lucio is able to heal multiple teammates at a slower rate while providing speed boosts to his pals. He's essential for escort because of this, doubly so because he's hard to hit and can keep enemies from rushing with his soundwave ability, which launches anyone back who dares to get close. But if you want to focus on faster individual healing with a character that can also boost damage, Mercy can be excellent for bolstering the front line from the rear. There are far more abilities than other characters, but one thing that's important to mention is ultimates. These devastating moves give you a brief moment where you can change the tide of a battle, either by reviving your team as Mercy, activating D.Va's self-destruct sequence with her mech, or freezing a group of enemies as Mei. They aren't solely meant to kill enemies across the board, but might only be useful to incapacitate or distract them for a time, or heal teammates, depending on which character's ult we're talking about. Even then, that's still an exceptionally broad generalization, glossing over how ults are all different by accomplishing similar tasks with varying pros and cons. Because of this, combining ults with team synergies when they're most effective. And you know, that really speaks for what makes Overwatch special to play.
Even though this is a multiplayer shooter, it's not your typical kind of multiplayer shooter because of how unique each character is and functions and how they all relate to one another. I mean, some of them technically don't even shoot. And that means that you'll be motivated to learn how to play as them all in the pursuit of having the jolliest cooperation with your team based on their needs. And that's the ever-shifting fun and spirit of Overwatch.
Figuring out which players should stick together, who your team needs on the battlefield at any given moment, and where everyone needs to be results in match after match where you aren't focused on playing as your main, but who will bring your team to the finish line. It confused me from the get-go how some characters had so little depth and complexity to their movesets, such as Bastion, McCree, and Reaper. After playing for several hours, I came to see that it didn't matter how easy some characters were to play as, because the depth and complexity I longed for with individual characters was misplaced. That satisfaction came in the metagame of calculating and adapting to each match by switching to different characters on the fly, and because of this, I've only played as each character for 2 hours on average after 40 hours of playtime. This ensures that playing as anyone rarely gets old, especially since enemy team compositions will always result in unexpected, ever-changing types of resistance. You may be playing the same three modes over and over for now, but matches never feel the same because of the diverse gameplay. And that's what makes Overwatch so, so compelling. So I've gotten this far without explicitly noting that while PC is the preferred platform, I've been playing on PS4, and it still feels like a dream for every character. This is a snappy shooter with endless playstyles that test your aiming and precision in numerous ways. And with a host of maps set around the world with excellent layouts, verticality, choke points, and general flow, they are wonderfully designed for the modes they complement. That's not to say that these maps are perfect, though. Temple of Anubis, Hanamura, and Volskaya Industries have some spawn locations for the defend team that feel a little closer to their points than they should be, which, on average, results in them winning more matches due to the ease of waltzing back into the fray, whereas the attack team has 3 to 4 times the distance to walk. Most of the time this isn't a problem, but a smart defensive team will take advantage of these spawn locations and choke points to an infuriating degree that makes some matches seem impossible to win, no matter how well your team performs. These complaints could be partially done away with in regard to some balancing issues, but as a whole, I'm shockingly impressed the game has been mostly fair with the scope of characters like this. Some heroes like McCree and Widowmaker have received satisfactory patches with decreased damage, and with Torbjorn receiving a debuff to his turrets, Blizzard is on the right track to further balancing the game. However, I do believe that other characters need work as well. Reaper should have a minor health or damage reduction to put him on par with the rest of his class.
Okay, time for Daddy to go do his work.
Hanzo's arrows should probably have a smaller hitbox.
Oh. Well, I'll take it, I guess.
D.Va should deal slightly more damage with her fusion cannons.
Today.
And Reinhardt's ult should have better range and a wider radius among other minor personal quibbles.
Oh, what a waste.
I could also mention the current state of a new competitive mode, but the amount of rage I'd probably express over its issues are best ignored since it will be receiving a do-over in the coming months with a new season, which I'm sure will be a lot more fun and fair for both sides. And you know, while the game is competitive and intense, most of the fun I've gotten from it comes from sheer satisfaction of beautiful cooperation. Winning is, I mean, it's obviously nice, but I still walk away from matches feeling rewarded, with teams that knew how to communicate and work together. There's an inherent positivism in the community because of this, which brings so many kinds of players together that you wouldn't usually see in games like this. A low learning curve helps with that too. While some have argued that Overwatch needs more content in its current state to justify the price tag, the fact that all new heroes, maps, and modes will be free is just icing on the cake for a game that's already well-rounded and endlessly entertaining. It kind of reminds me of Street Fighter V and how everyone knew that the game wasn't going to be complete upon full release, but everyone still complained that it didn't have enough content despite the fact that everything would be free from then on out. It's a criticism that doesn't really make sense to me. So yeah, with Overwatch, you'll scream with happiness and frustration in equal intervals, but even if you're having a bad night of playing, you'll be hard-pressed to stop in search of the thrill of being with teams that end up working together and crushing the opposition to perfection.
The excitement of capturing a point at the last moment. The rush of saving your entire team or single-handedly destroying the other with your ult. The unpredictability of who you'll play as next or against. In my opinion, Overwatch's gameplay doesn't miss a beat with the fun it provides with friends or even strangers. It's why my watch with Overwatch won't end anytime soon.
Visuals. This is one of the most aesthetically pleasing games I've come across in some time, and that's especially true for only counting shooters. It brims with a vibrant joy due to its Pixar-esque animation quality and style, aided by blasts of color and cartoony qualities that exceed the charm and memorability of Team Fortress 2's graphics. There's no question that, visually speaking, Overwatch will barely age with these timeless qualities. All of the characters' designs match their personalities to a T, and the beautiful maps are nothing alike, which will have you traveling to snowy monasteries, the canyons of the Wild West, and the breathtaking Greek town of Ilios, among other captivating lands that have lovely backdrops. As for the quality of the animation, there's a bounciness, if you will, and energetic quality to how characters move around, which honestly kind of reminds me of Firewatch. And it's aided by an oft-neglected yet amazing technique involving smear frames, which humorously elongate and stretch character proportions to produce this visual flair.
I'm your Huckleberry.
Why the long face, McCree? Tips invisible hats.
With minute facial expressions and body language that communicate more about their personalities than most animation in games has done, this game is an eye-popping treat that runs in 60 frames per second and bucks trends of grittiness and realism with amazing results. Audio. Overwatch's soundtrack is tinged with cultural instruments depending on where you are. Acoustic guitars, trumpets, and maracas enthusiastically greet you to the Mexican map of Dorado. Whereas the African city of Numbani welcomes players with a warming African choir and a xylophone. But what guides all these cultural twists is a hybrid soundtrack packed with grand orchestral themes and synthesized electronic beats. You'll genuinely be inspired by the grandiose brass as it confidently blares out in the main menu or with victory along with the sweeping strings and percussion, which reminds me of John Williams' heroic-sounding work for the Superman and Star Wars films, particularly and respectively the main theme and the track that concludes Episode 4. The electronic aspect usually plays as ambient music before matches begin or while navigating the main menu. It usually consists of low-key effects that sound chopped up and, for lack of a better word, chill. It can range from being calm at lower tempos to heart-pounding as it ramps up in intensity to conclude the last minutes of matches. While I wish the game didn't hide so much of the genius of the score by only playing small bits of much longer tracks, it's still a glorious oral complement to the good vibes this game inspires with its visuals. The same can be said for its sound effects. I don't really delve into these with my critiques, but Overwatch really is worth taking the time to show them off. The fact that I can instantly recognize most heroes by their footsteps and clothing slash armor ruffling around is an achievement in itself. But since each hero uses a kaleidoscope of equipment and weapons, everything they use has distinguished creative sound design behind it too. The creaking and groaning of Junkrat's metal traps when they ensnare someone is oddly satisfying. The growing pitch and volume of Zarya's particle cannon energy makes you feel like you're becoming more invincible. And the clicking and clacking of McCree's cowboy boots with the spurs make him sound like a true cowboy. Seriously, this is some darn sexy work on the sound team's part. Not only because they sound so high quality, but also because so much of it is imaginatively original and downright iconic in some cases. In regards to the voice acting, the actors and actresses recite lovely one-liners that will make you smile or roll your eyes in amusement, which complete the characters' cartoony appearances with exaggerated, stereotypical voices. Reaper, former Overwatch member and part of a Talon terrorist group, is essentially a wannabe Grim Reaper, and he fits the bill with a guttural deep voice that could sharpen any blade with the amount of, edge he exudes. He roleplays as his idol, with typical phrases such as,
"Back from the grave,"
or,
"Death walks among you,"
as seriously as possible, which comes across as cringeworthy yet enjoyable all at the same time. Mei has an adorable quiet voice who will alternate between English and her native Chinese language.
That could have gone better.
Oh, that's so sad. Oh, I'm sorry, Mei!
Zenyatta has a methodical, calming quality to his digitized, zen-like speech.
I am on fire. But an extinguisher is not required.
And Tracer, as most people know, has an awful yet infectiously charming British accent, which she accompanies with plenty of common phrases and vocabulary to let you know that she's indeed British.
Cheers, love! The cavalry's here! Oh, rubbish! Keep calm and Tracer on! Pip-pip cheerio! Tea and crumpets! Bollocks! See, I've got all the British sayings.
Some of the voices may come off as laughable at first like hers, but they match their characters very well, and since many of them will recite lines in another language depending on where they're from, this attribute of the audio is just one more point that sells and accentuates the natural, compelling diversity of Overwatch's cast. Value. There are currently three modes available to play under the Quick Play category in Overwatch. Thankfully, you won't find yourself stumbling into half-finished games that often or be waiting that long, since the category lives up to its name by quickly getting you into fresh matches without a hitch. There's also a Play versus AI mode, but once you adjust to the game's characters after a couple hours, there's no reason to touch this. However, Weekly Brawl is a fun little side mode that forces players to play as specific characters with altered stats. 1 week, teams might be able to play as only Soldier 76 with decreased health and stat recharging for Call of Duty-like mayhem. Another week, you might find that the support class is the only one available, and another might make things exciting by randomly switching your hero upon every death. It's a quirky mode that provides some laughs by switching things around for a change, but I hope to see several more modes in the future. Perhaps capture the flag, maps with moving points to capture? Only time will tell. Competitive mode, again, is not really worth commenting on at the moment in its less-than-desirable state of unfair time limits, luck-based favor for teams when matches are a tie, and horrible rank system, but it is okay. I just hope it will be far more enjoyable to earn golden weapons and rank up next season. But other than that, leveling up in general will unlock loot boxes that grant you cosmetic items. Costumes to wear, stickers to spray on maps' walls, voice lines, emotes, and the like are what you'll find. When it comes to the good stuff like high-tier costumes and currency, though, you can only pray and hope that fate shines well upon you when you open one. I honestly wish that cosmetics didn't require so much chance, since the only way you can hope to randomly win something you want is to buy more loot boxes. You can't even purchase the in-game currency, which I would have appreciated as an option, since hoping on Lady Luck to provide you with currency as well is a bit stingy on Blizzard's part. I wish there had been more to Overwatch's progression system related to story content, too. I would have rejoiced if there had been unlockable cutscenes, biography excerpts, audio journals, and more that give glimpses into the Overwatch universe by just leveling up or even completing specific challenges. Further customizations such as more weapon skins, minor cosmetics like maybe hats or glasses, and a color wheel for changing small aspects of characters' armor or clothing would have been nice as well, but I mean, at this point, I'm just nitpicking on a game that's already exceeded my expectations. Conclusion. Like I said at the beginning, it takes a lot for me to stay invested in a video game beyond its usual longevity. I'm usually in for the long haul with a campaign, but will cease to play any more of it once I've reached a standard ending. Multiplayer is a tougher case, which shouldn't only amuse me for about a dozen hours. It should be something I always want to come back to with friends, or even alone for months and months. Overwatch is the game I've been looking for that meets all these concerns of mine by always being a blast. Its 21 characters ooze personality and diversity, not only with their drastically differing arsenals and abilities, but also with their appearances, backstories, and voices, making them characters that are wholly unique in a landscape of multiplayer shooters you'll instantly gravitate toward and, eventually, fall in love with. Teamwork is an absolutely required virtue with gameplay, which is something that so many other multiplayer titles struggle to instill in players due to game design that allows and even encourages loner play. I know this because I'm inclined to do it. But with MOBA sensibilities in mind, you'll have fun learning to play outwardly rather than inwardly with Overwatch, whether you're used to that or not. You aren't just some cog in the machine here. You act and feel like an essential piece of the puzzle to victory, which provides a sense of belonging to teams and thrill I haven't had with any sort of multiplayer game in a long time, especially one that manages to be uncannily accessible. It contains oodles of replayability with a gorgeous, charming art style and animation, superb sound design, and modes that never grow stale to boot. This is easily one of my top contenders for 2016's Game of the Year, let alone this generation of consoles. So cheers, love. This world is worth fighting for.
Hello, my wunderbar patients. I wanted to save this for the end of the video because it's been a long time since I've uploaded anything of any sort. So this video is just to let you know that, yes, I do indeed still exist. I wanted to say this if it hasn't been said before, but I don't really have a lot of free time to make videos. It's something I do as a labor of love. I don't make anything from it. It's just something I like to do in my spare time. So you won't be seeing that many videos from me. Perhaps you'll be seeing one in a month or a couple weeks, maybe 3 months. I don't know. Maybe I'll come up with a Let's Play instead of a review soon. I can't say what the future will be, but I just want to clarify that I will not be making any more promises in regard to what I'll be uploading to this channel. Really, it'll always be a surprise, unless somehow this channel decides to skyrocket. But in the meantime, I mean, I've gotten like 180 subscribers over that, so that's kind of awesome. However, that doesn't mean I'm not doing anything. I put up my own website earlier this year. It contains all of my personal and published work, and it does look pretty snazzy, if I do say so myself. You can go check out all my writing there. I'm always doing that, so when I'm not making videos, feel free to check out my writing. And I should also mention that I have uploaded 2 videos on Push Square over the past couple of months in my spare time. So that kind of took up some of the creativity and labor of love stuff that I would usually devote to this channel to the Push Square channel. So you can go check those out too if you want. They're in the description, just so you know. Anyway, thank you very much for watching this ADP review for Overwatch. I hope you enjoyed it. Go ahead and leave some comments below about what you liked and disliked about it, what you'd like to see from me in the future, and, well, anything else that might tickle your fancy. But other than that, as always, thank you very much for watching, my patients. Now, if you'll excuse me, I gotta go play some more Overwatch, because, you know, it's kind of a good game.
There's not the cavalry here!